And so this brings us to the question of interculturality. I said that dialogue have a dialectical and a dialogical aspect. In a certain way, here you can see it's more linked to reason, and here is more linked to mythos. Think about this. With my students, when I have more time, I let them think, you know? But, so here I have to tell you. At the moment I talk about mythos, I become aware of it. I just ask you, is it still mythos? Remember, mythos is that which we don't see. It's like the light we see. It's what we believe so much that we don't believe that we believe it. So once we say it, we theorize it, is it still mythos or not? What do you think? No, it's not. It has become logos. So each time you have a dialogue, on the one hand, things become clearer, but at the same time, what happens was on an existential level, your mythos changes. But you don't know yet what kind of new mythos you're in. It's only little by little that this may also become revealed. So all the things that are presented now, the archetypes, all this, it was more imagine the dialogue is about I see the window through my window, the world through my window. As long as I only see this, and the more clean my window is, and the bigger my window is, I feel that that's the whole world. And then I'm meeting somebody else, he looks from a different window. Then, oh, I don't see that. Then I go, oh, what? So then I start to understand, oh, there's a different window. So then maybe I travel, and I try to come to his house, and I try to see things from his window. And then I come back to my window and say, hey, I have to open our window more, because you know they're talking about all these things that I didn't even see before. But even if we make our window bigger and bigger, the other window still exists. I still have to speak French, and I talk with my French. But your Japanese language will still exist. So there will always be your worldview, which will be on a deeper level, different. And we can never reduce that. So there is this deeper question of interculturality. And where I have been working on it a little more is in questions also of indigenous people, collective rights, for example. For example, in Canada, many of the traditional, the Mohawk, for example, they would say, oh, okay, you say now we have to find a new governance, find a new law. How can we? For us, it's like it's a cosmic law. I mean, if we have to use these words. It's not, we cannot change it like that. It's how things are. So you're on very different fundamental concepts about what the whole thing is about. And as human beings, we can always find some meeting points, you know, and so on. But I think it's very, very important. Unfortunately, I cannot talk about this so much more. But just be aware that the horizon of pluralism is much, much, much bigger. When I first came back from Brussels to Paris, after doing this legal theory, we did, and the professors came from all over the world, German professors, British professors, Spanish professors, and they did sociology of law and semiotics of law and many, many different things. Then I came back to France, and I discussed with another student, another PhD student, and we talked about interdisciplinarity. He said, oh, it's so important, I was just at the interdisciplinary conference. And so we talked for 20 minutes or something, it was so amazing and so challenging, you know. And he asked, what was it about actually? Because we were so like much talking about the theory, but we had not talked about what was the conference about. He said, oh, actually it was very, very challenging, actually, very challenging. It was like interdisciplinary between public law and penal law. Because in France, penal law is related to private law. So I said, oh, who are you? Okay. We are not talking about the same thing. For him, it was already a big existential shock, you know, like this, wow, we did dialogue with the, like, I don't know, public law people. That was tough. All these parts were not even there. Now, when we start to do all this, you know, we may feel like, oh, we did it, you know? But then realize that even like, maybe that's your uniformity, ethnocentrism, and then, you know, the levels of pluralism. And then maybe what we did here, maybe we are, you know, this person I was talking about is maybe here, you know? Maybe we moved a little here. But then the horizon we're talking about, you know, is much, much wider. And Etienne Leroy always used to say, when you think that you have become aware of your ethnocentrism, then become even more and more cautious. Because at the moment you think you have some certainties, best way of starting could be wrong. You're never certain of anything. Basically, humility. Which brings us to the whole of humanity.